Okay. I don't know those people. They're on a different plane of go existence
from
me.
That's true. Really strong go players are just, you know, like the really hot girl in the high school, right? Like, you just don't talk to her.
Yeah.
Can't even come within 30 feet.
You know the one that wins. Everybody else doesn't win.
Yeah.
Or when I was here a few weeks ago, and I think Z-Way is his name, offered me a game. I was like,
yeah. The prettiest girl at the ball just asked me to prom.
And she used to like demolish them.
Alright, so I guess officially it's 6:30, so we'll get started here.
6:31 and a half.
See? We're late. Today, a couple of things you should know. Number one, my baby had like a really nice Christmas and New Year and all that. We sent him back to daycare on Tuesday, and he immediately got sick, and then got me sick.
You know that's what daycare is for.
Dude, daycare is like just the breeding grounds for every like just virus that will just slay adults. Anyway, he's doing fine. Like he's over it. He's totally fine now, and I'm still here with like.
His immune system is just really compromised.
Plus, it's like that breast milk too, man.
Oh, that's well, you know, not bad. Strength
is on. So I've got this cloud of like
mucus
stuff here.
Yeah, everyone moves back.
Yeah, and for those of you who know me, I've also had like another ongoing sort of health issue this year. So I also went to the doctor this morning and had. Well, I also haven't. I've been putting off like getting a flu shot and a tetanus shot. They decided to do everything today. So I needed 9 vials of blood drawn for this other thing. And then I have a flu shot over here and a tetanus shot over here, and I'm still getting over this cold. So if I start saying things that don't make sense.
Call you out on it?
Yeah, just let me know and be like, Nick, you're sick. And I'll go like, yeah? Yeah, get me back on track. Just get me back on track. I really don't want to cancel class tonight. I really, because we have really big news. Because what is tonight called?
AlphaGo
strikes back.
AlphaGo strikes back.
So, like AlphaGo, this isn't like A New Hope where the rebels won.
Yeah.
AlphaGo won.
Well, if you look at
the humans who need to strike back.
A New Hope. The rebels won a battle. Right.
Right.
They just won a battle.
Yeah.
Like we still have the entire Galactic Empire.
Humans haven't even done that though.
No, we won Game 4 of Lee Sedol.
Yeah.
Game 4 of Lee Sedol.
So wouldn't that make Game 5?
We won a battle.
AlphaGo strikes back. Wouldn't that make Game 5? AlphaGo strikes back.
No, because that Game 5 was like Vader gets away. Okay, so this is AlphaGo strikes back because it is.
It makes a good title.
It makes a good title. I also just saw Star Wars. Did y'all see Star Wars?
I haven't seen it yet, but
no.
I'll make a trip through it eventually.
I enjoyed it thoroughly, but and I got all the symbolism, like the Saw Gerrera and the Che Guevara kind of parallels and these different rebel fighters. But God damn it, they didn't like develop any of the characters. They're just like the same character for 2.5 hours. Anyway, I enjoyed it though. So Star Wars. So we have that as well, and there was another reference Star Wars that I thought of that was really which we'll talk about later. There's another reason why I think the Star Wars reference is important. But if you haven't heard the news somehow and you've made it to this video, the past week Google revealed that on Chinese, I think it's 2 different Chinese Go servers, as well as the Korean Taijump server, it's been playing its Google AI, right, AlphaGo, against the world's top professionals.
Yeah, isn't it called, like, Master or something?
They've been calling it Master. And I kind of think it's funny because it's called Master P, because they put a little professional next to it, so it's Master P. Anyway. You guys are too young to know what I'm talking about. Or you're too old. They're too young. He's too old to know what I'm talking about.
I was busy with other stuff.
That's right. So they've been playing Master P against only other professional players. I think it's played about 60 games. And do you know how it did?
Won them all.
It won all of them.
Jesus.
Spoiler alert. Now, many of the games were very, very close. I think one of the Park Jung-won would challenge this thing. I think Park Jung, we're going to look at a Park Jung-won game today is what we're eventually going to work our way up to. Park Jung-won was the number one player in the world for probably the better part of at least a year or two, a few years ago, before KJ became sort of like the number one, certainly the number one in Korea for a while. But yeah, Park Jung-won kept playing this thing. I think he played it like five times. And anyway, he played a half-point game against it where AlphaGo won by a half-point. Miyu Ting, who I did a little lecture a while ago on, quite a while ago, a really strong, really young Chinese player, he had a half-point game against it. But, you know, many of these pros were challenged a few times. We actually have a few game records from these, you know, these excursions against AlphaGo. Now, that being said, these were all basically blitz games, with the exception of one game which had slightly longer time limits, which I think was the Ni Weiping game.
And blitz usually favors...
Yes. Right, it was definitely playing on its home turf. Most of the games were 20 seconds or 30 seconds a move. And AlphaGo, in those games, pretty much almost always moved, or clicked at least, you know, whatever, the move was recorded between 7 and 8 seconds into that time. So it was not using its full time ever. It was probably making good use of its opponent's time. But it was basically any time between 7 and 8 seconds into that time limit, it would click a move. Very consistently. So of course there are a lot of people who are speculating, like, this is obviously a robot. Right. So for the previous week before this, while I was playing, you know, at the end of 2016, going into 2017, there were a lot of people in China and Korea in particular who were like, this is AlphaGo. Shh.
Don't tell them we know.
Don't tell them. So right, and I think most of these pros who played it kinda may have figured that out as well.
I think I remember hearing that Keijia in particular knew it was AlphaGo, like
just from the start. Yeah,
yeah, like, or like was told or something.
Yeah, So first of all, Keijia says a lot of crap. He's still kind of like a bratty kid, or 20-something-year-old now. I guess he's in his early 20s, and he says a lot of crap. But I'm sure he had a pretty good clue. Mm-hmm. He might not have been 100% sure, and one of the reasons why he played it because he wanted to find out for himself, kind of thing. But I don't know if Google specifically told him, you need to play this because it's AlphaGo. But they probably did contact him after the fact.
I highly doubt they probably told him before. But...
probably not. And this has actually raised another cause for concern because, you know, let's say Google did this whole experiment and then AlphaGo lost a game, or several games, or most of the games. Would, you know, Google still publish the fact that this is AlphaGo? I mean, like, this wasn't really like a scientifically, what do you call it? Ethical experiment, right? Like, this is very much set up in a way such to only benefit Google by trying out their AlphaGo across the world's top pros. They were doing it in secret in such a way that they'd only reveal the results if AlphaGo won everything.
I don't know. It feels really cocky.
It's very biased, and it's certainly not, you know, in the realm of like the scientific method or in the greater vision of improving humanity. It was done in such a way very much to showcase Google and how awesome AI, our AI, is for its own benefit. So there's a little bit of I'll call it a backlash, but it's very small just compared to the people who are just more interested in what AlphaGo does. And man, AlphaGo does some things.
Yeah, so, it's really good.
And so before we get to the game, I'll show you some of the things AlphaGo does. Yeah.
So do these people suspect AlphaGo because of any particular characteristics or just because it was just so damn good?
Number one, it was beating, they hadn't lost a game, it was beating all of the best.
Yeah, it was so damn good.
That would be number one. But number two, I'll show you some of the characteristics.
Also, it came up like super fast.
Yeah.
Well, no, that was like someone off the radar. Super fast, you say it's a robot. Which robot?
Well, I mean, like, AlphaGo came out, like, beat this really famous person, like, last year.
Yeah.
Then this year, the same year, this, like, upstart with very, like, powerful characteristics in this game comes out in certain game. It's kind of like...
well, maybe it was a clone. Someone stole a clone. Mm-hmm.
What move would you play here as black?
I would say...
Like R15.
Approach from the bottom.
So we have a vote for R15, this one?
Yeah, and AlphaGo does the one.
It's pretty normal. Orthodox.
R6.
R6, absolutely.
Yeah.
Right, these are probably the two most normal. These? AlphaGo doesn't like these.
Does it do the large knight?
Yes.
Yeah.
AlphaGo really likes this one and this one.
Whoa, that's insane.
And just to exemplify even further, if AlphaGo plays here, and I think there's maybe two or three games that went almost in this exact fashion. AlphaGo's next move was usually here. And this is also true, it's even more true if it's like that. Again, AlphaGo likes shoulder hits. And we knew this from the Lee Sedol games, right? AlphaGo likes shoulder hits. But in these blitz games, it was playing them really early on into these openings. And basically, it was almost as if you ever had two stones kind of forming some sort of, you know, quasi-developmental base thing, AlphaGo was like, yep, that's yours.
I'm going to take everything else.
Yeah.
So AlphaGo is like just really quick to jump in.
It's not jumping in, though. It's like, I'm not interested. I'm not going to try to invade you. I'm just going to say, yep, that's yours. I'm just going to solidify you and build out.
It's exchange of potential.
I didn't mean like jumping in the area. I'm saying that once you start doing something, he's AlphaGo is kind of attracted to that area.
Sure. But it likes making your opponent feel over concentrated, I guess. Even though this isn't really over concentrated,
yeah.
As you exchange a stone, it seems to like that. Another thing AlphaGo likes to do is it really likes to tanuki away from this. And so like this would be like a very typical AlphaGo opening.
Yeah.
This is very prototypical AlphaGo style.
Two-thirds of the board of AlphaGo.
Hmm?
That's all AlphaGo's foil.
All AlphaGo.
Very big box.
I really like this. It likes this one as well. And whenever it thinks it needs territory, it actually almost always defends this with this move, which is a nice move. But it's a little bit weird in terms of spacing. Just a stone two spaces away from a one space jump is kind of locally inefficient. This is an interesting shape. I'm just pointing out shapes that AlphaGo really likes for some reason. I've played this one a whole lot of times. There are some new Joseki patterns that AlphaGo seems to like. Here's one.
Let's say here. Is it like,
I'll make AlphaGo black.
Just newly popular because of AlphaGo.
Say this again?
Is it newly popular because of AlphaGo, or is it like a whole new...
Like, I'm showing you things that are... That, like, people already know about... But like AlphaGo really likes.
Okay.
So like, have you guys? You guys know this Joseki?
Which one?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
All right. Next move.
Build a base.
We usually build a base. Isn't that what AlphaGo plays?
What?
Does shoulder hit the P bet 15B?
No. You can play this sometimes, but often it would push in here once more. It would make this exchange, and then make a base or play out here. Do whatever. Do it, then come back and do this. So this exchange is not normal. This is a very abnormal move, and it did this many times.
Or it's playing white, or it's playing black.
It's playing black.
So it plays black and basically convinces his opponent to make that move.
Yeah, it's just an exchange of one stone, but for a Joseki as common as this,
yeah.
That's a pretty huge difference. Because normally, if you guys are playing a game, and I was watching over your board, and Kellen plays here, I would point at him and yell at him and say, "Why did you do this? This is not Joseki." Because not. But AlphaGo really likes making this exchange.
And now we can say, but AlphaGo doesn't.
But I know. Well, that's the thing. So after the Lee Sedol game, Jenny Shen, right, Chinese Go professional, lives in the United States, teaches here. Attends all the US Go congresses. She only has a few students these days, but I at the US Go congress, she was talking about teaching her students, and she's like, I can't teach them anymore. Because I know nothing. Like, it's like there is now AlphaGo. And all they have to say to me is, well, AlphaGo played it, and I have no response for them. You know, so...
Rogues play a lot of things. Doesn't mean that you should play them too.
Yeah, well, and I think, like, in the, like, one game that I think... I'm not going to go over tonight, but if you guys want to look up a game, look up, I think it was the Mi Yu Ting game. I don't know which date it was. I don't know if there's multiple Mi Yu Ting games, but there's a Mi Yu Ting game. It's M-I-Y-U-T-I-N-G, where AlphaGo is just pushing from behind on the second line, letting, you know, Ming Yu Ting build this giant wall on this side of the board.
Huh.
And it is so weird. It's like, these are bad moves. And it wasn't like a couple pushes you need to get liberties, because he had captured the AlphaGo, she had captured the corner. And so she needed to push on a couple times to get liberties to make sure the corner was dead, but I kept doing it beyond the point where she needed liberties. Like when you push behind on the second line, you're saying, this one point here on this line is more important than any central influence I can have, than I give you.
Is there any subsequent effect that maybe...
I'm encouraging you guys to go look up the game and study it, yeah, but I mean, like, I'm just looking at it going, this is a bad move. I saw other people comment the same thing on that game. They were like, that's a weird move. Like, that was... We don't know. Like, we just don't know what it was thinking. And, you know, it is programmed to win the game, not win the game with the most elegant or most points or most, you know, hand of God type of moves.
It just wants to solidify once it's...
And so maybe it was that part of the programming, but it still happened kind of early on in the game where like, it's not reading the entire...
Maybe it thought it was winning already.
Maybe it was winning already.
You know, so there's some weird things. And again, that turned out to be a half-point game. It was a half-point win for AlphaGo. Several of these games were half-point wins. Quite a few were like 1.5-point wins.
Well, maybe this is like the spontaneous emergence of modesty.
I think it's more like stubbing your nose, if anything.
Robot learned to be modest. I'll show you a few other things that it likes. It really likes... All right, let's say AlphaGo is black again. Yeah. Normal approach. What are your options as a human player? What do you normally think of moves to consider?
14.
Back off.
Like it?
Yeah.
AlphaGo likes this one. Good. What else do you like?
Pincer.
Pincer? AlphaGo does not like this one. I don't think it ever played this in any of the games. I could be wrong. Again, I didn't go through them all with like a fine-tooth comb.
Did it do other pincers?
Almost never.
Never.
Basically never. Like, all this,
wow.
All this, no. No good. Doesn't like it.
That's good. Pincers stress me out.
I really like pincers.
So isn't that amazing?
That's like super bizarre.
Right? Basically, you know, when you respond directly to an attachment, you really have maybe 3.5 options, right? One is to like attack or put pressure on the stone directly. One is to go build your own thing. A third thing is to just like make the shape into something heavier first and then do something with it. And maybe the fourth is just to like sort of come out. These are sort of like maybe your four options from this type of user. Maybe I guess the fifth one, you just take the corner, but. But anyway, one of the most major lines, right? Is this like not in its vocabulary? And again, this is after playing itself, you know, many thousands, I don't know how many times over and over again, and sort of learning. It's sort of learned not to like this move, it seems, or it would seem.
Like, do people ever pincer AlphaGo, and do they get money?
Yes, and so, this is actually the other interesting bit. When people play this move against AlphaGo, so let's pretend AlphaGo is white now, it would play almost the normal Joseki with one twist. And the new twist isn't actually that new. Other pros have been playing this twist, but... do you guys know this Joseki?
Yeah.
I mean, we've covered it before. I should look at least normal. Where's the move for black?
It's the jump. Or, wait, no, it's connection.
Connect.
Yeah.
Right? Fix. All guys will play this. I'll play this. And so this is actually not an unknown Joseki. This is sort of an accepted modern variation, but just the fact that AlphaGo does not play this one. And only plays this one. It's kind of interesting. So that's what happens when other people pinch your AlphaGo. It plays this and it thinks it's fine. It thinks it's winning. The other move, I promised there were three moves that AlphaGo liked. Did I say that? Did I give you guys a number?
No.
Okay, so there was one.
Yeah.
All right, so we said no on these. So you gotta find two more moves that AlphaGo will play.
Will the
attachment
be
on
AlphaGo?
This one?
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
Nope.
F-16?
This one. Yes, I like this one a lot.
Tanuki?
No. In this case, no. AlphaGo seems very Tanuki happy. Usually when it's approached like this, again, the games that I went through and the other commentary I read through did not. I don't think I saw a situation where Tanuki had this position. I would always respond with at least one of these three options. Here.
B16?
Large knight?
Keep the more.
B16, this one?
Keep the core?
No.
C15, even though it looks really.
That's the one.
Really?
It likes this one a lot.
Jesus.
Even when it's not traditionally appropriate.
Even when it's not traditionally appropriate. Usually play this if black already has a stone. And this is actually really considered to be a very strong move. Because white comes out, and black jumps out, and white can still invade here. This is too open. This stone doesn't actually fix the invasion. But the second white does, black is going to make a huge outside. But even without a stone here, AlphaGo likes this. AlphaGo likes this.
So with these observations that AlphaGo maybe doesn't like certain things, is there a frenzied activity by the top pros to study up on the court?
Yes. Sure, yes. Every pro is looking at these tendencies and going, wait, are we wrong, or is AlphaGo just sort of like taught itself its own weird culture?
It's like sat in a year.
The question is like, are the pros wrong in the opening, or is AlphaGo doing this in its own technique and it's so strong in like the middle game it just wins? It's kind of one of the questions.
And you kind of expect that, you know, with an AI that's so complex, there's going to be a little bit of like chaos theory kind of happening, right? Where like you get some unintended consequences or findings, not because they're right, but because, you know, just a little imperfection somewhere else down the road turns into a learned mechanism.
Or maybe somehow that the way the games are represented inside the memory, whatever, that there might be some subtle little bias or something that causes that.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Like that.
But yes, every top professional is re-evaluating this, right? This is like, what did we miss, guys? Like, why is this working so much?
It sounds like it spent the last year alone in a room meditating and it's forgotten how to be human.
Well, this is, all right, so remember my Star Wars reference earlier?
Oh, yeah.
I had a moment where I was reading through a bunch of these games back to back. And where I truly, felt like, whoa. Like, we are communicating with something else. Like, something alien. Like, this really does feel like we're talking with something else, right? In Japanese, have ego, right? Hand talk, right? Go is an act of communication. And I just had to, like, stop. I was like, I'm done. Like, this is weirding me out. Because we are talking with something, through these games. And so I had a little like alien encounter kind of moment, when realizing that this thing speaks a different language. And so for me, I was like, I have to go teach this class tomorrow.
So that AlphaGo has this preferences.
Mm-hmm.
It would seem that if there is in fact some data-driven reason why these are to be preferred, then studied by the top pros might sooner or later enlighten us.
Yeah, that's a study, right? Is that professional players will look at all these preferences and readjust our own knowledge of the game, right? That's the dream.
But the other possibility would be if AlphaGo has somehow been suddenly misled.
That's like a million dollar question.
This shows that AlphaGo can't play against these moves that it's making, right? Because it's playing these moves because it can't find a way to beat them.
It favors them.
So perhaps it's just not good at replying to.
It's really good.
It is scary good is mm-hmm. the other thing.
Yeah.
And in the part of the reason why I want to show you this Park Jung-un game here in a moment is because AlphaGo is convinced that it's endgame so early on into the game. Like, this is, like you know, by move 100, basically AlphaGo is like, yep, the game's over, let's just play endgame moves. And that's it. Right, there's nothing else, there's nothing else of large interest to the game. There are a few other games that ended mostly in resignations. But the games where the middle game became prolonged, AlphaGo would kill something and just, you know, win abruptly. But here, we'll come back to that. I want to show you just a couple other tendencies that, you know, I picked up on. AlphaGo's black again. We'll do it this way. All right, so you're AlphaGo. What's your move? What are your favorite things to do?
Pull back.
Yeah, let's say this or this.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And doesn't really matter which one. Let's do this one for now. If white plays here, normal, yeah. Do you know what AlphaGo's response is? Well, how or what? Give me a move. What would you play?
3-3.
3-3 would be normal, right? It's not AlphaGo's move.
C8.
C8 would also be a normal move, not AlphaGo's move.
D6.
D6 is a special case move, and we actually saw a formation kind of like this in one of the Lee Sedol games, where the position was a little different. But not AlphaGo's move.
D7?
D7 is a good guess, not AlphaGo's move.
C5?
Yes! I didn't care to finish this. And it seemed not to care if it was this here or here. Both times, it would often, I think a majority of the time, not continue to play this corner.
So it just doesn't value the corner over Sente?
It's like, I have two stones there, I have a group. I'm done.
Yeah. And it can just make this stone safe. Either by the 3-3 or...
Well, this way is dangerous, though. Because there's only one eye here, actually. So, I wouldn't call it safe. It's just, it can... Like, it has enough confidence in itself or something to just say, yeah, they're just two stones, and I can deal with it later. Like, I don't need to make points here. So, really, really interesting. Here's another scenario. White, AlphaGo pulls back. White plays here. Do you guys know this Joseki?
C4, I think.
Yes. White move. Here. Play this move first. Now the Joseki has two choices. AlphaGo doesn't like either one. But what are the two Joseki moves?
B5.
Yep, block. You know, build a wall, let white take the corner. Other option.
Build a wall the other way.
Yeah. Make white take a small corner and build this way. Those are the two Joseki moves. You know what AlphaGo likes to play here?
D7.
Nope. Good try.
More Tanuki.
Yes. Done. Does not like to complete this formation. Does not complete this Joseki.
Yeah.
Really weird. Really weird. Because, you know, it seems with white, when white plays a move here, white's connected out this way. Now black can't make eye shape over here. And black's just going to come under attack. With two moves, you have a floating group. And white has points and a base and can build more. Seems really bad, but AlphaGo don't care.
So I assume players then tried doing those things against this. What did AlphaGo do about it?
It dealt with every situation beautifully. I mean, it just deals with it.
What proportion of these games have been played in the last couple weeks there?
All of them.
Finish the question. What proportion of these games did the players start with a strong suspicion we were playing?
I don't know.
It probably happened fairly quickly after it started winning a lot. It'd
be interesting if they could dial it down to plays of a single master, past master. Like, it played as if it was
Oh, oh sure, so give it a personality, yeah.
That would be insane.
Instead, because it's pulling all the information from all these past masters.
Yeah, sure, but it doesn't know like these past masters' characteristics.
Yeah, but I mean, you could teach it based on a set of past
masters. So like most of its data set is from it playing itself.
Right.
Yeah, but you can see that with a...
Yeah.
Right. So I mean, perhaps, but that's a fundamental different problem, though.
Google
AI wants to be better than humans right now, and so impersonating humans is a different.
Yeah, it's a different AI problem entirely.
Although, a lot of people feel like AlphaGo has a direct connection to Go Sagan, because a lot of the moves that Go Sagan liked to play, for instance, you know, like this type of formation, right during his new Fuseki period. And this one as well, AlphaGo likes too, and even the shoulder hit, right? Like Ghost, when Ghost Sagan was here, like Ghost Sagan thought this was a very strong move. And so there is this Ghost Sagan AlphaGo connection as far as, you know, past players are. Most people are convinced that, you know, Ghost Sagan made mistakes. Like, we can see his games, we can see his mistakes. Ghost Sagan will get beat by AlphaGo, right? His games are not perfect.
Yeah. Wow.
But. There is a feeling that a lot of AlphaGo style is part of that Go Sagan new Fuseki idea.
He didn't die that long ago. Maybe he got a chance to upload his brain to.
Yes, that's what AlphaGo actually
is. It likes one space jumps into the middle. It really likes one space jumps. Doing this sort of thing. It likes these types of things. It will do this sort of thing too if you have two. If there's a formation, it still likes one space jumps. But that we kind of knew. I had a list of like things I wanted to tell you that it really likes. And I'm running out of what I remember.
Well, it's really good at moving around making Sentai moves, I guess.
Oh, yeah. Really, it plays very fast.
Yeah.
It plays very, very fast.
Which sounds like they fine-tune that, because when he was playing Lisa Do, it took a long time.
No, I mean fast in terms of style.
Oh.
Yeah, like you'll play a move over here, then they'll move over here, move over here, move over
yes.
here.
Yes.
Yeah.
Play fast in style. I mean, it plays fast literally in terms of time, too.
Yeah. Well, it's a computer.
But again, Google intentionally wanted it to play online Blitz games, right?
Because those are the ones that favorite.
Because this will benefit Alpha, though. Right. You want to see... At least part of, I don't want to do the whole game, the whole Park Jung-Wong game. I'll tell you again. You already know who wins.
Surprise.
Park Jung-Wong does lose this one by a point and a half.
How? We'll see how he wins or loses.
Well, I can. I'll.
We'll see the Lego.
It's not the destination, man.
It's all about
the journey. It's all
about the journey.
Alright, so AlphaGo is white here. You guys can. Play along. What is this called?
Chinese.
And AlphaGo immediately approaches here. And we actually went over this like in class, like before break. You know what it is? Like this exact formation. You know what the most popular pro move is? What the pros decided was the best response?
It's a high.
Kellen already played it, huh? Right. Oh, by the way, before the AlphaGo news this past week, I wanted to do another lecture like the statistical pro favorite moves, or most likely board positions. That was my plan for tonight's class originally, but I killed it. We'll do it again later.
That'll still exist.
It still exists. We're still going to do it.
Does it still exist? Did AlphaGo break any of them?
I don't know. Well, that's the thing, right? I mean, I have to teach it to you now before it becomes out of date.
Now it has to be taught.
I should have taught that tonight, because that's just going to be out of date. All the information a month from now. But also, just on our calendar, next week's a holiday, so no class. The week after, I've got Andrew Jackson to come here, so we're going to play a game live for you and just, you know, kibitz and call each other names and stuff. Okay, AlphaGo plays here. This is reasonable, right? This is very big.
Yeah.
Like, this is a little overextended, perhaps. So AlphaGo is immediately going to ask, hey, do you want this?
Yeah.
If we just play this,
yeah,
that's a little, it feels a little bigger than it should be. It feels a little larger. So that's reasonable. not unexpected. AlphaGo here. And Parkinson 1 said, yes, I want this. And so even though AlphaGo will tanuki at this point, right, this is the exact same Joseki we just kind of showed you, you know, Parkinson 1 finishes it. Done. So black sente, what does black play?
Lower left.
Yeah, I would. This would be like my natural inclination, but Park Chung Wan plays here.
Okay.
I'm not sure why. AlphaGo move. Three choices, right?
Back off.
Or 15. Back
off. Lower high.
High.
Well. You don't want to go answer the phone and just say, Seattle Go Center, we're having a class right now. Thanks, John. AlphaGo plays low. I think AlphaGo could play high, right? You have support. But maybe AlphaGo already sees this big wall here. And is like, this side is not mine, because black can just invade here, because it has friends. So it takes a more defensive posture. And then Park Tanukis. This is very like AlphaGo style, like AlphaGo would do this sort of thing. And what do you think AlphaGo does now?
Backs up low again.
Yeah. You're AlphaGo.
Yay.
Kyle is AlphaGo.
Confirmed.
Alright, next move is a fairly recent move that has sort of, the last couple of years, you see a lot of more professionals making. Normally, if we just want to make a base, what do we do down here?
Two space extension.
We can do this directly.
Yeah. So sad though.
Yeah, we can do this. Ask for the corner first, then do this. The problem with this, of course, is white's going to kick and over-concentrate us. If we ask for three spaces, we might be asking for an invasion. If we do this, we're just trying to keep maximum flexibility. We're saying, okay, I know you can invade. But let's be really flexible about it. Right, and if you really get a severe invasion by white, black can still jump in and take the corner. All right, this move. This was perhaps the most shocking move this whole game for me. You know, as where I'm in my own go skills, it's not going to be that shocking for Q players. Okay. In fact, some of you guys can actually probably guess where it is. It's probably a spot where you would play without too much hesitation. But it was actually really shocking for me. It's not Tengen. No. I'm just going to play it.
Okay. Yeah.
So does anyone know why this would be shocking for me?
You're playing into the Chinese.
Yeah, you're playing into black's influence, right? But he already has you pincered. And we're playing low. Normally, the way to deal, if you're going to play into this thing, you usually play high. Because when you play low, what's going to happen to you?
You're going to get
attacked. Yeah, you're immediately going to get attacked. Just you have no room to make eyes. You are just on the run. And while you're on the run, what is black going to build here and here?
Well,
in this case, probably just territory. Just straight up territory. AlphaGo plays this, like, magically. Like, this is some freaking David Copperfield stuff going on. This is just... So anyway, yeah, if you're like a Don level Go player, you don't play this. You just get attacked. It's like saying, here, opponent, take 30 points of territory just while I'm running around the board. We do not like to play this. But AlphaGo plays here. What's the problem with this move?
It's not connected.
It's not connected. So guess what Park Chung Wan does?
Cuts.
Push. I'm going to check out the move order. Instead of blocking here, this would be block, right? Push, block, cut. AlphaGo plays here first. And at this point, this might, if you're a Q player, this, you're like, this is the shocking move, right? And no, the shocking move happened back here. because you play this one, or she played this one, she also has to find moves like this. And you have three crap turds of stones here. That Park Jung-won just says, they're just little rabbit poops. That's all they are. Like, there's nothing to them. What is AlphaGo looking for?
Aji,
yeah, looking for cuts and basically looking for free stuff. Can we make shape? Maybe. Hey, if you let me connect, I'll be happy. You can take that territory. Maybe I'll just build a giant wall here. I'd be happy with that. Or if you leave your defects, maybe I can go and invade this or eat a stone. Park Jung-won insists, rabbit poop. Rabbit poop. So we have Aji. And connect, of course. Now, after white has a stone here, white comes back and plays this. Black's going, look. All right, so now you're a bigger piece of rabbit poop. But remember how this thing, you were just going to run out this way, and I was just going to make territory over here and over here? That's still the plan. Like, that's still what we're going to do. You're still just going to run this way. I'm going to take my corner, take some points. Maybe I'll instead of getting this territory, I'll get a bigger middle now. But whatever it is, you're still running. I'm still getting building potential. AlphaGo plays here. Black says, oh, now we have to cut you. You did not run. You're back to rabbit poop. All right, so right now, who thinks these two stones are going to live? Okay? Who thinks these three stones are going to live? All right. Who thinks these two stones are going to live?
It's hard to choose which one.
It's hard to choose which ones. They all look terrible.
Yeah. It seems like you can't save all of them.
Well,
but I can't choose which one. Seems most likely this guy.
This is what AlphaGo's really good at, though. Yeah. AlphaGo makes a lot of sacrifices. Like, continuously just throwing down stones on the board that are going to die. And just to get another free move or another extra point or something on one of these other non-will-not-die kind of groups. And so, anyway, the play continues. Honey, extend. AlphaGo is actually going to make these live.
Oh, God.
Tetsuji. So this throw in here allows Black to do all these other moves in Senpei. And Black comes out here. Now right now, this white T shape is not 100% alive. It still needs at least one more move to become alive. It's almost alive. It's alive, certainly, I mean, Black needs to not let these die, of course. But White actually still has momentum here. So we don't actually have to make them alive yet. So White plays a few extra exchanges, right? If these are alive, we can eat these. I don't have to come back and play this move. So Black has to crawl the second line. White takes another forcing move. And then White is just taking all the free stuff. And now, White says, okay, you have a lot of liberties now, I'm scared. Come back and make life. So, as of right now, Black doesn't look bad. It's like, hey, these are trash, right? Actually, Black's next move is here. Black needs a move here to make sure these don't kill this stick.
I would say maybe Black is going to be running out of liberties on that group on the side. That,
this one?
Yeah.
That's at six liberties right now. Six is a lot.
About maybe he wanted to extend another.
Oh, but this?
Yeah.
Too slow. Yeah. You need to. Well, what happens when White attacks this stone and gets any other friends over here?
Yeah.
It's bad news. So Black really needs to do something. This doesn't quite work. This is not the game. Not the game. I'm just showing. Because these two are in trouble and these four are in trouble. So this is why this is just fine. But AlphaGo says, oh, ha. Huh. This move is a little funny. Let's play this move. Black now has to push up.
How weird is that move?
This move, it's actually not that weird, but what's weird is that it works so well. Because white, in turn, that captures these two, right? You gotta see if white connects, just dead. White makes a strong shape out here. All right, so now let's look at this position. Who had this corner before?
Black.
And he had a pincer stone. And what were we expecting when white came in deep?
Black was going to run white out.
Black was going to run white out. Black would get a bunch of points here and solidify a bunch of points here. What did black actually get?
Half the quarter.
Well, 4 points here.
Some side.
Sure. Maybe a half point here.
Top strong.
A point here. This got a little bit stronger, but there's still Aji here. There's still two friendly stones for white to utilize later. So we got a little bit of building going on here, but
it feels like a really good result for white.
Doesn't it?
Yeah.
Isn't that magical?
Yeah.
And so again, it goes all back to like AlphaGo being able to, you know, have the confidence or the knowledge or the foresight, whatever you want to call it, be able to go in deep here. And that's the part that's amazing and scary and like, whoa. Kind of like this thing that we all know how it should have played out didn't happen at all. Where AlphaGo just calmly lived in the corner, even got some outside shape. And black, you know, gained a little bit. But it was blacks to begin with, so.
Yeah, it was like supposed to have really big blacks.
Yeah. That's scary. All right, so at this point, this black stone feels a little scared, you know, now that white has some strength. We play out a few more moves. This is Joseki. You guys seen this Joseki before? And then white plays the toughest variation, at least as far as the outside. First, although it actually settles quite peacefully, because white has these outside stones now. Atari, extend, Atari. So who got what here?
Black got the corner,
white got the outside. Hey, this was white's corner, black got white's corner. So again, black's corner, white got black's corner. Black's corner, or white's corner, black got white's corner. Fair, right? What did white get?
White got the influence, especially up.
Yeah, and again, this group wasn't 100% safe, right? But after white gets a little bit stronger here, it feels a little more comfortable. There is Aji here.
Okay.
There is actually quite a bit of Aji here. And black kind of threatens to take advantage of it right away. Or at least, if this were to run out in some sort of ladder, right now it's not quite a ladder, it's more of a net type of formation. But black, this one. Again, just prepping any sort of ladder variation, as well as doing what else? This does at least three things. This type of move.
It tries to build the top.
Yeah, look at this, right? Remember how this white got our corner? We did get to stick our heads out a little bit further than we started. So we have to make use of that. So we can build some more here. What else does this do?
It puts pressure on the side.
This is already alive, so not much pressure, but reduces.
Okay.
Reduces the potential. So white can't build something really big here. But white plays this move. Very strange looking move.
Like,
I have no idea how long that was off for.
Okay, just be like, YouTube, the game was great.
Yes, YouTube, you missed all the most amazing insights. I have no idea how much of the game you missed. My camera shut off. I really need a new camera.
You could splice that in afterwards.
I can splice this. Oh, the part that was missing?
Yeah.
Oh, that involves work, and I have a baby, and I'm sick.
Make the baby do it.
Yeah, make the baby do it. You know what the baby does? I'm like, baby, let's go edit some Go videos. And you know what he does? Actually, he's really happy for like 2 minutes because he loves like screens, like big bright square boxes.
And then he goes for the keyboard.
Yeah, and then he's unhappy.
So this is why you should come to class because you might miss it.
That's right. All you people on YouTube, if you don't want to miss any of Nick Sawicki's Go lectures, you need to be here in class. So anyway, we were talking about this move and how weird it is. Like I mean, it doesn't not make sense. It's like, hey,
it's like AlphaGo.
White doesn't want to get corralled in here.
Like AlphaGo kind of the score. He's like, I need this many points.
I think it's the same sort of thing.
I get the feeling that the AlphaGo said, I'm going to take the side, they never let that black stone up, I'm going to take the side, and I have some good exposure for hitting into the center.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you can reason through it exactly like that, right? It's like, hey, we prevented ourselves from getting closed in, gets us some more points. Hey, I don't get shut out here. Black can't make something big here. But again, it's like so slow and mishmash, wishy-washy.
It feels like you're trying to justify a bad move with reasoning that you don't follow.
Yeah,
I don't know.
And maybe this is like the most beautiful move we've ever found, right? And I'm sure people of a higher skill level, you know, higher Don or Pro will look at this and go, oh, of course, it makes beautiful sense.
It seems to me that black stone is getting pretty much constrained in there.
Which one? This one?
Yeah.
Constrained? It has friends here. It has friends.
He's getting a little... I think he's starting to have some intelligence.
There's still space in here, though, right? There's
not much. He's got a big base in there. If one pops out, cuts spots.
But he can attach and make shape and...
Yeah.
I mean, do this little elephant jump and...
But, you know, AlphaGo seems to be happy for what if you just base it smaller.
Well, also, AlphaGo's next move is here, which actually indirectly also helps this.
Yeah.
So grow the middle. And this move, right, this move makes total sense. Park's move. Mm-hmm. Sorry, Park's move. I said AlphaGo. Again, gloopy.
The human.
I took Sudafed twice this week.
Ready to take on the world.
I guess. This move is like human, right?
Yeah.
This move, like, hey, I have something, I want to grow it. Hey, you have something, I want to shrink it. Right? And it's a very appropriate amount of space. But, yeah, for the people who are saying, this stone feels lonely, John?
Yeah.
All right. But Park has a response. And... Tanuki down here. We're gonna ask some questions of this group. I mean, this is kind of a weird formation. This is the type of formation you have when you're building an entire side. I mean, it works as a group too, but. Park plays here. Yeah. Letting ourselves be cut from our group. It's actually totally fine. Because all AlphaGo really wants, it turns out, is just a little more central influence. So we run this stone down. And we just connect. That gets that. Now normally we'd expect to see a white move here would be the conservative move. White plays this one, which is a little bit greedy. And leaves Aji for later. Oh no, actually this one does require a response though. So okay. Maybe not that greedy, because it's Sente. So what happened to our friend?
Pretty much hit.
Hmm?
The black one.
Yeah, totally got separated. Black got two extra stones. Actually, yeah, that's kind of a disaster for black.
So surely black's a
big cut that one off. White's now building the side again.
Yeah. So that remember that formation I just pointed out was like kind of abnormal?
Yeah.
This is why you don't do that, kids. Don't play that way. White plays here. So this move does many things. Tell me the many things it does. This move is also very human, by the way.
It says at the top.
It's very what?
Human. Human. I know, I'm not enunciating anymore, because again, the mucus makes me just go like, eh.
Just think you know what the words he's saying.
Yeah, I just think. Actually, I just turn on, like, people can subtitle my videos now.
Yeah, because the subtitles on there always work.
Well, the fun part about a video like this, where you can't understand anything I'm saying anyway, is you can just make up whatever you want.
Just play the Empire Strikes Back, the whole, like, videos or audio all over.
Doesn't make
sense.
Looks like it builds out, white, builds out from White's side, reduces Black's middle.
Yeah, those are the two major things I can
And this way.
Yeah.
It, you know, actually starts to threaten this cut, right? It helps this fight for this stone. It helps expand this. It threatens to make this into something. And, remember that giant thing Black's building? It reduces that. That's a really nice move.
And why it's not taken. Why there in particular?
As opposed to like here?
You know, anywhere in that general neighborhood.
It's not behind enemy lines for one, but it's really close to enemy
lines. Yeah, so if we wanted a move that just reduced, right, we can play there pretty confidently, right, without any problems. If we play deeper, Black's going to counterattack us and reduce us while doing it.
Uh-huh.
So we don't want to get counterattacked.
Uh-huh.
And even here, we might get counterattacked a little bit, so we're making sure we're not getting counterattacked. AlphaGo has also done the math and figured out that if Black just takes this territory and White gets this territory, Black doesn't win this game. So all we need to do is seal the line in there, and we win. So it's very hard to counterattack, and if Black seals in, we lose. Or he loses.
We win.
As far as, you know, it could be closer, which would be even safer, but we're getting fewer points. It has a nice relationship going this direction, because this attachment is actually quite powerful. Because I think after this Hane, I think this crosscut works. Because of this stone. So, it lets us seal that off. It's, I don't know, it has many uses. Maybe later on too, we can play moves like, if Black doesn't respond, we can continue to go in further and possibly save all these stones. So, it's just a really nice point. Oh, did I do this way out of order? Holy crap. What did I do? No, I didn't.
Yay. Way to psych us out.
Oh my god. My wife asked me before I left here, are you okay to drive? I have no idea. No idea. All right, back on track. We're just going to do about 12 more moves.
Yes, that's the move I want to see. Is this pretty
this
big?
One.
Yeah, isn't this pretty big for Black?
Oh, yeah.
So I guess maybe AlphaGo figured that, sure, but these other moves were bigger.
Well, this is a beautiful move, though, right?
Yeah. It is a nice one to play it.
Like, look, it does this, and it can build this, and it can cut off this. There's so many things.
So those cute players might say, oh, that's a great grand move, but AlphaGo said, oh, but there was one that was bigger. That's...
Yes. So yeah, White actually gives up all these points to Black.
Oh.
So. And then White continues to just reduce this.
Oh, yeah. That's
so it was exchange. Exchange this for these points. Black plays one peep here. Again, sort of trying to help with this potential cut fight thing. White's pushing into Black, so Black's going to mutually destruct the White territory. This actually threatens to cut through and or link up. So Black fixes it this way. There we go. Continue to destroy. Destroy. Play here. Hey, this move looks really good now.
Yeah. It is the whole thing.
I can't explain it. It looks nice.
So would this be a good time for, I mean, it looks like just off-center there, you got kind of
kind of big empty space. This is this a good time for Black to try to move into that?
Into what space?
Just right.
Into here.
I feel like
towards the center.
Oh, in here.
Yeah.
Where, how does Black make points here, though?
Well,
he's saying to trash it so White doesn't get it.
Black still has these two as a liability right now.
Yeah.
Right, because there's still a little potential for a cut here. But at this point, I'll just play a few more moves. This is endgame.
Really?
AlphaGo is like, you know, I have enough. And not that endgames are uninteresting. But White just makes a shape here. Well, I guess it's not a game, because White does cut himself. Never mind, I lied. It was more than 100 moves. Well, it'll settle. It'll settle real fast. I think.
Settle.
So how are we dealing with this? Victor.
Lost the top.
I mean, the game is close, right? Black gained a lot of points down here. Still has this corner. Still gained some points over here. Still has this. I mean, it's a close game.
So Black still has hopes of
I think so, yeah. I mean, they play out the rest of this. And, yeah, this was premature to say that this was the rest of this was endgame because this is still not 100% connected. So I played that one. But most of these moves, yeah, that's very territorial. Right, just defend those points. And now finally White comes back down here. Plays here. White prevents any eye space. And now Black just connects. Now we can say basically the rest is endgame. All the groups are set. And so if we look at this board, again, White wins by a point and a half. White does make a number of points here. Black does get all this. Black gets, you know, a fair share down here, this corner. You know, it's points for White, some points for White. It's a game. But he loses. But Park Jung-won, you know, loses again. And again, I think this is either his fourth game or fifth game against AlphaGo. Because he just kept challenging it like every day. He'd log on to the internet and go play this thing. Yeah, so what does this mean?
The era of humanity.
Yeah, we all need to go rent Terminator 2 Judgment Day.
That'll be interesting to see. So basically be like a totally different entity playing the game that we'll have to try to understand.
There were quotes from like Guli and Kenshin, some pros, to the effect of, alright, well, humans have been studying Go for thousands of years and now we're about to learn that everything we know is wrong.
Yeah, I mean, well, it's, but we're still not sure, right?
I mean, there are some moves that seemed weird, but then worked out. Are there moves that people have identified that, or maybe from this game, that we would call mistakes were it a human playing them?
You know, there's certainly some interesting choices.
Mm-hmm.
And I think most of the professional community agrees that you don't question AlphaGo right now. Because if you do, you're going to get burned. And so it seems like a lot of them, sort of like these you know, stupid-looking moves, end up being right in the exact same place, or the exact place that they need to be, you know, 12 moves later.
Mm-hmm.
One other tendency AlphaGo has that I wanted to mention earlier. AlphaGo, in this game we've talked about, not this game. In this class, I'm going to use some words. Here we go. Here are the words. In this class, we've talked about spacing. And spacing, we talked about like five space extensions, yes? Ring a bell?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What's good about five space extensions?
Yeah, your opponent can't easily make a base.
Right, it's like the maximum space you can go without your opponent being able to make a two-space base inside of it. And so they're really efficient. Do you know what AlphaGo thinks of five-space extensions?
Trash. They're too small.
They're too small.
Jesus.
Why go five when you can go six? And that's not always the case, but it makes six-space extensions surprisingly frequently. Like, surprisingly frequently. And it's not trying to position moves in five-space extension configurations or variations. Right? A lot of times a pro will choose a variation because it ends with like a five-space extension between this stone and this stone. That's why they choose this variation. AlphaGo doesn't seem to care about maintaining that relationship. All it really cares about is, hey, do I have two stones in an area? That's enough power for me. I can go as far as I want. And so it makes a lot of shoulder hits. It makes a lot of six-space extensions. Makes a lot of large enclosures. It also invades. I mean, even though it values the outside, or it seems like it values the outside, it is certainly super happy to invade. One of the last games I read, I think it was another Park Jung-won game, but it might have been a Kidja game. I read through AlphaGo, I think, invaded the 3-3 point on move like 14 or something of the game. Was just like, hey, I have something over here. All right, I eat your 3-3 point. And I mean, obviously it won. So it's hard to even say that it has like this style, like it just has these tendencies where it doesn't always take the outside.
I wonder how many of these tendencies are just because like it's so much stronger than us that it might be like on its own level that it can just get away with certain
things. It's playing teaching games.
Yeah, I know, it's tough. Yeah. It's tough. Is it just that much stronger that it can do whatever it wants? It's like, you know, it's like Go Sig and it can play what, you know.
Yeah. I just wonder if
whatever
like,
spot it wants on the board.
AI for it to fight that was like on a similar level other than AlphaGo.
It'd be interesting to see like its self-playing games. See what.
Yeah, I don't know if that would be as interesting as people would think.
Well, we have seen a few of them, right? They've actually released a few.
Has anyone taken advantage of these recent games to maybe reanalyze the way the world moves? And there was commentary.
I'm sure people are thinking about it. I mean, I'm sure that's in the back of everyone's mind.
I mean, there was commentary after that tournament, but as one, has anyone reanalyze it.
Here's the thing. This is news as of this week.
Yeah.
In my like YouTube video queue, I'm kind of behind on my editing, and I'm gonna actually try to push this one up to the front so this one comes up sooner than later. My next few videos that are going on the internet, you people will be out of order, assuming that this one has enough video content. We just didn't delete the entire middle hour of footage.
Just boneless technical difficulty cards.
I know. I need a new camera.
So maybe take over Wednesday class this week so you can redo this to get the better finish job.
Oh, man. Maybe, but that's not going to happen. So, this is all really new.
Yeah.
Right, this is all real. This is news. And so I know the AGA is going to do a series of, you know, pro review commentary videos pretty soon. I think they're still working out their own details. So everyone's just trying to generate, you know, their own analysis and commentary and...
Well, it's something that's so big. It's like basically someone that's better than so many other players before just crops up and is...
Well, now there's no doubt that it's better than all the pros. Instead of just like...
It's better than
all the pros. Well, certainly at Blitz.
It's better at all the pros at Blitz, which is a very big caveat because... Computers tend to do better at certain time intervals.
Yeah.
If you think about the stuff that happened with chess, like so long ago, and I'm pretty sure AlphaGo will get maybe to a point where it can just do pros flat out.
But if it's not better than every pro at longer games now, it will be soon.
It's very hard to make an argument that even with different time settings, this thing still won't win. The efficiency of its moves, the lack of like mistakes.
Slack moves are just not a
thing. You know, even its moves that seem dubious, you know, 12 moves later become really important.
That has a purpose.
Yeah. Well, so very scary in that sense.
I wonder if all of the training and all of the experience AlphaGo has collected, I mean, on one hand, if you get enough, maybe all the details kind of work over the general picture, the specific game to look at that matter, but on the other hand, I wonder if maybe with a different training experience that you could maybe get a million out the door that plays a different.
Well, that was kind of like Ian wanting it to be different styles, right?
Yeah.
Like, could you make a Joe Sagan Alphago, and
it's,
you know,
it's difficult to
Sadal
do
Alphago.
That now, and if you wanted to remake that Alphago and see if a different, like, pattern came out, that would take a lot of time,
right.
From what I understand.
Well, okay, but, all right, so but here's the point that I want to focus your attention on.
Yeah.
For, I think, Go enthusiasts and so many professionals, the first question you have to ask yourself is like, is this the best move? Like, is AlphaGo actually discovering the winning move each time it's going through its tree search? And obviously, AlphaGo is not computing every variation of the game of Go. It can't do that. But is it bringing us closer to that, you know, hand of God idea of Go?
It's definitely closer.
Right.
Yeah.
And so how much closer? That's still, we're still sort of asking that question.
Yes.
If you ask the Google team is, you know, they're, I don't think they're quite, what's the word, not pious,
humble?
Humble, yeah, humble enough about that idea?
Well, the problem is it's so complicated at this point, we don't even know how close it would be to the hand of God.
It's like reaching that goal that we don't actually know where the goal is.
Yeah.
You know, I think there was a quote, or a proverb or something, you know, it's quite old, that was, you know, something to the effect of, the world's strongest Go player takes 3 stones from God. Right? You know, so if you play this, you know, overarch knowing being to have a fair game, you're about 3 stones down.
So are you saying that Alphago would take 2 stones at this point?
I'm not saying anything. I'm just reminded of that type of discussion, okay? And so the unfortunate thing, I think, for me, as thinking about Go as an art form or as a transcendence of humanity, as a you know, penultimate kind of game that we've either created or discovered, Go, the AlphaGo robot may not actually be discovering, you know, the true meaning behind the board, and just creating a different culture, a different language for playing the game that we are not used to. And maybe that language or culture is more efficient and stronger than ours. And maybe it does nudge us closer to the ultimate answer.
I think it just prioritizes winning more.
But exactly, that's my problem with it.
Okay.
And so the fact that it tries to win games by 0.5, right? That irks on like an artistic or moral level so many strong
goals. Isn't it kind of like that one Japanese professional or something that did all these ugly moves that you said or something like that? I can't remember the guy's name.
Where
other
pros, like Kobayashi.
Yeah.
It's Kobayashi Koichi.
Yeah.
Yes.
Where other pros don't like it because they're like, it's not like,
yes,
artful. So.
Yeah. It's like the ultimate pragmatist, right? Does it win the game? Yes? Okay, it's good. Is it the best move?
I think that comes down maybe to a bit of the choice, because you're like telling the AI that winning is the highest priority, not scoring or beating your opponent as harshly as you can, which is like two slightly different, but in this case very different things. To like, oh, I just need 0.5 point versus, oh, I have to play the best moves and try to show them that.
Yeah, there are different questions, and a lot of people play Go for different reasons, and you know there is this cultural difference. Like in Japan, right? Go is this, you know, and you know, we're the Seattle Go Center. We were started by the Japanese. There's very much a lot of this in the United States, how Americans specifically view Go, and a lot of the rest of the world, right? Go is like this artistic expression, right? It is this outlet of humanity manifested on this infinite board. And then there's like the Korean and Chinese version, which is much more like sports. It's like, go team! You know, it's like, kill the stones! And I'm caricaturing both, you know, cultures here quite a bit.
AlphaGo feels a lot more like the Chinese.
But that's the way Go's been going, right?
Yeah.
If you look at tournament time limits, right, they've been getting shorter and shorter because of television and advertising and making it more like into an event, a sporting event. You know, people really aren't playing, you know, 20-hour games anymore, right? That was really a product of this Japanese idea of what Go, you know, transcends. And yeah, are we being cheated a little bit? You know, at least for those of us who feel like Go is this ultimate expression, this art form, this something that transcends humanity, are we being cheated out of that because of this robot?
Do you know much about, I don't, do you know much about what happened, the effect on the culture and chess when this happened there?
So chess is... here's the thing. Andrew Jackson is going to be here in 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. He's been actually thinking a lot about that. Mm-hmm. And he's actually put down Go for a while, and he's been taking up chess like almost exclusively for like the last 3 to 6 months or something.
Hmm. So what's he trying to do with that?
Well, I think part of his interest was he wanted to know what was going to happen to Go after the robots are ubiquitous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like once Google AI is AlphaGo. Is no longer this like super secret thing Google has under wraps and only like top pros can play it and secret Korean and Chinese Go servers.
It's sort of like once you don't have to adjust the back of the dance yourself, but you have a little gizmo to do it.
Yeah, right. So what happens to Go when that happens for everyone? And that's already happened to chess.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So he was sort of looking at chess and going, well, what happens when we actually have computers that?
Well, it's interesting. Like I played a lot of chess and you kind of. Playing a computer is very disheartening in my mind because it's just, oh, you made a mistake here and the game's over.
Yeah.
I don't know how it is for the higher AIs. I know some of the other ones take more in positioning, but like for the intermediate AIs and intermediate players, it's never about position. It's just,
mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
It's kind of leads to a loss.
I think, and I'm going to put this on camera because and Andrew Jackson's not here, but I'm pretty sure. And it's hard for me to remember, recall exactly, but I'm pretty sure he invited me to play a game of chess, you know, sometime in the last month or two, and I beat him. And I haven't thought about chess in a while, so I made me feel pretty good. But again, he had, like, never played chess, and I played, like, chess team in high school and stuff, so it was a good game.
Yeah.
I think.
That's an interesting game for
you. I'm, like, 90% sure that happened.
90% is 100%, right?
I know. We'll ask. He'll be here. You can ask him yourself.
You need someone to drive you.
Here's the thing. Him and I both have, like, babies right now. Like, we're not sure of anything.
So like, what do you think the Google team should do in order to teach the current pros how to get better?
The Google team has no interest in doing that.
If they want to.
The Google...
The only thing I can think of is if you have like a log of like what the thing was thinking about at this point in time. Mm-hmm. So for example, might not have
of every game and so on.
Sure, but the Google team is not that interested in this.
Okay, suppose they were.
I don't want to pretend.
Okay.
They published a paper on right because this isn't actually Google itself. It's a different subsidiary of
DeepMind.
Yeah.
And I think they're more of a research company. So they're relying on, you know, public research to do, right? They were relying on a bunch of recent breakthroughs, and they published a paper.
Yeah. Is the one that's on Nature?
I think so. It was the one they published shortly before the Lisa Dorn match, or around the time of the Lisa Dorn match.
The idea of this to show the strengths.
Maybe.
Are you raising your hand, Mark or Ian? No. Oh, okay.
So
I started patiently waiting there to say something.
And I didn't look into this at all apart from seeing it, but someone just posted on GitHub an open source attempt at implementing like ideas from the AlphaGo paper. Mm. So it's but what they haven't released is like training data or any significant amount on what the result of all the machine learning they did at AlphaGo.
Yeah, there hasn't. They're still working on it, theoretically, and also working on what it's going to be or how it's going to contribute something. Right, so...
I thought it was supposed to show, like, this kind of technology is going to work for, like, self-driving cars or some other
application. I think that's certainly true, but I think they're actually going to... take the neural network application and start trying to you know, remap it for all these other tasks, you know, fairly, within Google at least.
This is getting like a scary level of AI.
Right, and actually going to the self-driving car things, I'm still amazed, right, how many people out in the world, right, think self-driving cars are never going to happen.
Oh, there's people that think flying planes for airports aren't going to be a thing necessarily back home. It's like, there's no way that's not going to be a thing.
Yeah, they already half are. I mean,
yeah, they already half are.
Yeah.
Well, I forget what the exact hardware was they're using. A dozen CPUs, maybe 48 GPUs. And so I'm wondering, I'm not familiar with that stuff anymore. I don't know how big it is, whatever, but how many pounds of hardware, how many kilowatts does it take to drive it?
The AlphaGo that beat Lee Sedol was running on like several server racks.
Also ASICs. ASICs. So like custom hardware that's only doing predictions for that model.
Right.
Well, I imagine like
so that's faster than
GPUs,
right? Right.
Might be your biggest cost for something that's crazy.
I think you get rapidly diminishing returns when you increase the computing power. Intuitively, it would make sense that it increases
logarithmically. They are using a lot of hardware.
Yeah, but the point is that even if you run it on a single pretty powerful machine, it's still going to be pretty damn strong.
And in 1995, I got a hard drive that had 2 gigabytes of storage on it.
Wow.
And that was so much.
And there's probably a lot of software
optimization
that can be done. So this is going to, I mean, the amount of computing hardware you need to do this is going to fall rapidly.
There's several problems with certain hardware.
I mean, there's two different phases. Yeah. I mean, one is when you do the training to get some sort of representation. Maybe that can be taken from the training machine. How big does that have to be?
I don't know.
So, in conclusion, I welcome our new alien friend.
It's really interesting, I think, to see it played because it plays some things and I'm like, this feels really bizarre, even from my like lower standpoint, where it's just like, oh, I don't care about this.
Maybe we should all self-demote to 30Q now.
Maybe.
How about you do that?
All right, but anyway, when the first human beats this thing, we'll be back here. We'll do Return of the Jedi.
How long do you think that will be?